Welcome to Loco Gringo, Mexico, the place where we transform a tourist into a traveler, because you deserve to see more of the world than just what's in a guidebook. Each week, we talk with amazing locals who know the Riviera Maya and Yucatan like only a local can, and get them to share their tips and insights on the local scene, culture, and cuisine from a local's perspective. So, pour yourself a margarita, grab a comfy chair, and let's get the show going.
Hi, my name's Kay Walton, and welcome to Loco Gringo's podcast today. Hey, heads up, this podcast is going to be a little bit long because we have a fascinating person we're speaking with today. This gentleman and my dear friend lives in Merida, Yucatan. He has been featured in Condé Nast Traveler, Elle Decoration, the Miami Herald, National Geographic Traveler, the New Yorker, the New York Times, Plate, Sabor, and Travel and Leisure Magazine. And the list goes on. He's been made a big celeb by cooking with Martha Stewart and taking her shopping out in Merida. And he is also was out last week getting some great eats with Rick Bayless. So, needless to say, this person's passion is food and Yucatecan food at that. He's published a book that came out in 2014, Yucatan, Recipes from a Culinary Expedition. And I'm proud to say this man is also my friend. If I can, let me introduce to you Chef David Sterling. My name's Kay, I'm with the Loco Gringo, and today I'm really thrilled to be talking to a dear friend of mine who I never get to see enough of, Chef David Sterling, and David is in Merida. Hey, David, how are you?
I'm good. How are you today? How's the weather over there? Is it stormy yet? It's getting stormy here.
Oh, no. No. You know what? Today, I'm overlooking the sea while we're talking, and it was really windy for 3 days. It's laid down. We got a little bit cooler temperature, so it's great sleeping, and the sea is absolutely beautiful. So, you know, to be here, it doesn't suck, yeah?
That sounds wonderful. I'll be right over.
Okay, come on over. Come on over. So, David, I wanted to find out, you know, we've been friends, we've known each other for years and things, and I know that you're from New York, you came from New York to Merida, but tell me a little bit more, because I know you are a man of many faces and a great, interesting history. So if you can give me a little bit about your journey and how'd you end up in Merida?
Well, I was actually born in Oklahoma. Land of the Red Man, is that which is what that literally means, translated into one of the indigenous languages. And I grew up there, went to school there, and lived there for 25 years. During that time, in all of my childhood, actually, through my adolescence, I had two tracks that I pursued, art and food. And it's always been that way. When I was a kid, I was puttering in the kitchen with my mother and my dad. My dad had been a baker in his his younger days. And so we made cinnamon rolls together and cooked all kinds of things together. And my mother taught me that if you add vanilla to chocolate, it really helps the flavor of the chocolate. Later, only much later, did I learn that was a Maya formula. The Mayas were the first ones to use vanilla in the chocolate. But
really?
Yeah. So, you know, I had a little foundation that way. But really, it wasn't until, well, actually, step back a bit. In that same time period, when I was a teenager, Julia Child first appeared on television, and you could say I was obsessed with her, and I think that would not be too strong a word. I actually had a little tape recorder. Those were the days of a little reel-to-reel tape recorder. And before today's, MP3 players and all that sort of thing, and DVDs and CDs. So I would record her on when she came on television, and then I would transcribe all the recipes. I'm not joking. I was a weird kid, and I started cooking that way. Soon thereafter, I didn't have to do that because she came out with the French Chef Cookbook, and I was just a poor kid, but I was able to afford that. Later, I got the big set of two volumes of Mastering the Art of French Cooking. But meanwhile, I had started to cook in the kitchen. I was 16, 17 years old. And you know, completely obsessed with French cooking at that point. Shortly thereafter, by the time before, I didn't leave home until I was about 25. And in that time period, still in early adolescence or young adulthood, I had a very good friend in Oklahoma who had studied Mexican food, and he started teaching me the recipes that he knew. And he just studied it normally, but we would cook together, and that was kind of my first foray into Mexican food. I had been to Mexico, again, as a teenager. I begged my parents to take me to Mexico when I was about 13 years old, and we traveled here, actually just to El Paso, but for me that was thrilling, and went with my aunt and uncle, and I'll never forget it, and I came back with a treasure trove of tourist items, like a little Pancho Villa marionette, I remember, and then I became obsessed with Mexico, and I started traveling here. Before I left Oklahoma, I came here at least two times with friends. We went to Mexico City, and I just became this all emerged really because in Oklahoma City public schools in the 1960s, for some miraculous reason of progressiveness, they started requiring foreign language in junior high, and which I think, to think back of the 60s, it seems really a very modern idea, and
very progressive
at that time. So you could take either French or Spanish. I'm happy that I chose Spanish because it served me well, and I started studying that in fifth grade, and I have never stopped. I studied it all the way into high school. I then got a scholarship for Spanish in college, and then by that time I was traveling even more here. I came probably once a year for several years, and in any case, to continue on with the art and design theme, I moved away from Oklahoma. I went to graduate school in design in Michigan. It's a school called Cranbrook, and it's a pretty well-known art academy, and I went there for an MFA in design, and meanwhile, to support myself, I worked after hours as a pantry chef in a really high-tone French restaurant there called Le Bijou, and I worked there just a couple of years. It was enough time to let me know that I really didn't like the restaurant business.
It's a hard industry.
It's a very hard industry. And I was not of the temperament for that. Even though I was young and energetic at that point, you know, starting at 6 p.m. and ending at 1 a.m. every day, it was just too much. And then getting up and doing school things. So, And it wasn't just the schedule, but also the temperaments and personalities involved. I happened to have a really horrible executive chef who I just couldn't stand, and he and I had many clashes. And anyway, I just thought this is no fun at all. Cooking is supposed to be fun, and it was just so stressful and so on. So anyway, that let me know that. It was probably a good thing I was doing design on the other part of the day because I needed to have a job, and I think I was headed toward design. And while I was still in Michigan, though, I did start a tiny little catering company, my just really for friends and acquaintances and friends of friends, and did a few catering gigs, which then I moved to New York in 1978, and you see how old I am, and started doing the catering thing there too, again very informally, just small dinner parties for friends, and but it was a little bit of income, and I still hoped that I could somehow nurture that career, because I just loved food so much. But meanwhile, I started in design, which is what I had the training for to do, and got a job as an art director at a magazine that's now defunct. Sadly, it was around for many years. Goodness, it must have been at least 50 years, and called ID. It used to be Industrial Design Magazine. Then they changed it to be International Design Magazine, and it was a very popular magazine in the design community, and it was all about product design mainly, product and some interior design. Anyway, I was the art director for that magazine for 3 years. And
now was that new? I'm sorry, was that in New York then, or were you still in Michigan?
Yeah, no, that was in New York. That was by the time I had moved to New York.
Oh, okay.
And then I had linked up with a fellow classmate from Cranbrook named Jane. She was from New York, and when she finished her work at Cranbrook, she came back home, and we linked up, and we decided to start our own magazine about design and product design and so on. And we wanted to get at the subject matter from a gut feeling rather than an intellectual or cerebral feeling or a stance. So we called our magazine Fetish, and it was not sexual. It was not sexual in nature, but it was the passion that many of us feel for objects. We had a lot of collectors who, we did stories about collections. We did stories about Betsy Johnson before she was really known. We did stories about Robert Venturi. A lot of people let us interview them, which was great. And we got a really great reputation. We were hits in Japan. They loved our magazine. And it went for about, we only produced 3 issues that stretched out over about 2 years. It was just kind of self-funded. But meanwhile, we were in the New York Times. We were in every kind of, you know, we were interviewed on radio. We were interviewed on television. We just got a great publicity boost from doing that magazine. And that was at the time of discos and clubs and all that nightlife. And that was something that, because of the fashion involved, that was something that we often would feature. And it was, you know, it was pretty much ahead of its time, I guess I would say, because later, since then, there have been other magazines come out that have a similar slant, like wallpaper, for example. Ours was kind of a avant-garde wallpaper, you might say. Radical punk version of wallpaper, but you know, Jane and I just legally and also because of our passion, we decided to start our own design business that kind of spun out of the magazine. Lots of the clubs and discos started having us do logos for them. We did the original Danceteria logo. We did work even for Studio 54 at one point, and we did party planning and invitations for Cher when she launched a fragrance, and we did all kinds of things like that were great, great fun that all spun out of the magazine, and that really led to our early work in our design company, and we did an awful lot of entertainment work. There is a festival, a big festival of avant-garde performance at Brooklyn Academy of Music that's known as Next Wave. It's been around for years. And we did all the original promotion for that. And it was radical stuff, really avant-garde, crazy, wild graphic design. And that was a lot of fun. Meanwhile, though, as we tried to kind of button down our collars and become a little more corporate and a little more profitable in our business, we started getting somewhat more, not conservative, but just a little more normal kinds of clients, like, for example, restaurants and food companies. So there you have food coming back into my life again. And I did that work for about, I guess Jane and I were partners for about 12 years, business partners. And then I reached a time in my life, I was rounding the corner into my 40s and not quite midlife yet, I suppose, but getting there. And I just thought I had pushed around enough pieces of type, printed enough pieces of paper that I thought, this can't go on. This is just a little, it's repetitive. It's not that meaningful. I just felt like at a certain point, it just didn't have a lot of meaning to me anymore. Trying to help promote people to make a lot of money. And because we got into some very big corporate accounts with Citibank and Amway Corporation and Chase, a lot of different big corporate things. And I just felt that there was kind of a vulgarness to it that just got to me after a while. And so I decided to leave that, and I started with another business partner named Mark Randall, and he and I started a company called World Studio International, and World Studio. And that was intended to be and was work that would be based on doing a lot of work for nonprofit organizations, getting involved with the design community so that we would all have a social conscience and social responsibility. This was in the early 90s when those buzzwords were really newish, actually. Well, after the 70s. And they were coming back when Bill Clinton was coming into office. And this was a whole new era of hope and dreams and doing the right thing and making the world a better place, and hence the name World Studio. And we decided that graphic design, not graphic designers, but all designers had a tremendous responsibility because we were giving shape to the material world. And as such, we needed to understand what materials we were using, their sustainability, their ecological impact, and not only that, but impact on communities. How are we helping poor people, or are we? How can we, if there is a way? So in conjunction with our studio, which was really slanted in that direction, we started a nonprofit foundation, our own nonprofit foundation, which continues to the present. It's called World Studio Foundation. And the gist of it was to award scholarships and internship opportunities to disadvantaged students of art, architecture, and design. And we got a lot of corporate support from Adobe. I mean, this is, of course, over the, makes it sound so easy. This is over the course of years of struggle and pleading and so on, but it became quite successful. Adobe and many big companies, Microsoft, supported us. And then we got linked in with AIGA, which was the American Institute of Graphic Arts. And they became really our biggest supporter. And we kind of partnered with them to award these scholarships once a year. To the present, we have awarded over $1 million in scholarships. Through
incredible. Yeah. Congratulations. Yeah. That's great.
Thanks. Yeah, it is. It's wonderful. It's very rewarding. I think that the an equally rewarding aspect to it is the internship programs that we also sponsored. We would get people like W.K. Kellogg Foundation supported us for a big, big project, and many other. Adobe was another one. We would do these come-up projects. For example, there's one that my friend, that Mark, my business partner, former business partner, just sent me. We will have a case where we'll set up an internship with a famous or you know, well-known professional designer with a young student, most of them, sometimes high school, most of them are in college, and all of them are ethnic minorities or disadvantaged economically, and they work alongside the designer, and they decide what they want to do. They want to come up with a project that involves design and that would solve a community problem. So Mark just sent me a brand new one that happened recently. This young man working with his mentor came up with the idea of helping homeless women and their children by creating something that would give them income and give them work as much as anything. That was the important component, so that they felt purposeful. And they came up with a food product line. Again, there's the food notion. Mark is also very involved in food. So they take leftover thing. There's a farmer's market there. And the farmer's market often will, you know, at the end of a couple of days, their fruit hasn't sold or whatever. They have leftover fruits. And so they donate this to this kitchen. And this kitchen that this young guy started turns those things into jams and jellies and preserves. And then those go back to the farmer's market and are sold there. And it's the homeless women that he employs that produce these jams in the kitchen. They do all the training there for that. They did some beautiful graphics for the packaging. It's very sophisticated and it looks very desirable. And they're having a great success. They said that their most popular flavor was Tomatillo and Lime. This just came out. That was their top seller. And so, you know, it's a very wonderful accomplishment. I mean, Mark and I cannot take credit for it except giving them the opportunity to do this and arranging for the mentorships and so on. But
can I interrupt you? Can I interrupt you for a second?
Sure.
So we've got a bunch of listeners. You and I know what tomatillo is. Do you want to explain to people what tomatillo is when you talk about tomatillo and lime?
Yeah, tomatillo is people call it a green tomato, but it's not a tomato at all. It's actually in the gooseberry family. But it's the, anytime you have a green sauce in Mexican restaurants, salsa verde as we call it, that's made of tomatillo.
Okay, yeah.
And, It's a tart flavor, and it looks like a tomato, only green, but it is not a tomato. It's not like an unripe tomato or something. It's a totally different species, but it's a very tart flavor, and it's used widely in Mexican cooking, particularly for this green sauce that I mentioned that we put on flautas and fajitas and all kinds of things. But yeah, it's a delicious tart flavor.
Great. No, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, but I knew there's going to be people who are going to go, I ain't never heard of a tomatillo.
What's that? Well, they've eaten it. They just don't know maybe what it's
called. What it's called.
It's, if you come to Mexico and are here for more than 5 minutes, you're going to eat tomatillo because all of our green sauces that you get on the table have that in it. Sometimes they'll mix it with avocado as well, and that's when it's not very hot. Sometimes it can be a little picante if we have some chiles in it, but it can go either way. Always ask your waiter, is this hot or not, and or just eat it and suffer the consequences.
Now, it sounds like you've already lived like 5 lives. We've got, you know, baking at home and your passion for Julia Childs and your design work and everything. And your nonprofit is amazing. Where did Mexico suddenly fit into that big picture?
Well, so as I mentioned, I had been coming down here for a lot of years. And all that time when I was still in Oklahoma, even when I was in Michigan, and then after I moved to New York, I made regular trips down here. Not every year, but every few years. And I explored quite a bit. And when the first time I came to Merida, Yucatan, was in 1988 or 89. And I had a very good friend from New York who a few years before, she had done she was in advertising as well. And so that's kind of how we linked up and knew each other. And she did a big campaign for Revlon with her agency. And she made a lot of money. And she decided to kind of retire, or she took a big sabbatical and came to San Miguel de Allende and over in the center part of the country and decided to write her first novel. So she took a year off and she wrote a novel which was published and was rather successful. And then she kind of stayed in Mexico. And meanwhile, she and a friend had traveled over to Yucatan, really liked it, and traveled all over the peninsula and went over to where you are and just kind of fell in love with it. And then meanwhile, she fell in love with a Yucatecan man and who had at one time been the mayor of Progreso here. And they got married, had kids, and she stayed. And so that year in 19, I had visited her in San Miguel. Then I came back in that late 80s, 88 or 89, and visited her while she was living here in Merida. And I explored around then as well. I went down into Chiapas and even down into Guatemala on my own and just really, really liked it. And but then it wasn't to come back again for another decade or more. She was still living here. Keith and I were living in New York. And we were just 5 blocks from the World Trade Center. And when that tragedy happened, we were out of our apartments for a couple of weeks. And it was very stressful, as everyone knows. And after we got back in our apartment and things sort of started calming down to an extent, Lisa and I were talking on the phone. That's her name, Elizabeth. And she said, you guys need a break. Why don't you come down, come down here for Christmas and get away from all of that. And so we did. And that was just December, which was, you know, just a few couple of months after the horrible thing. And we came down here, and on our first day, when we woke up after arriving late at night, she said, "I've arranged for a realtor to take you around and show you properties." She had been she had been telling me that's Elizabeth for you. She's a little demonstrative, and I won't say controlling, but anyway, I said, "I want to go look at the ruins. I want to go to Uxmal. I want to go to Chichen. I don't want to look at property." And but she had told us before we came, "You should really think about it because it's a good investment. A lot of expats are moving here. They're buying these ruined properties and fixing them up and selling them for a profit. You could do that or keep it as an investment for retirement or whatever. You should just think about it." And so indeed, we went around that morning and looked at properties, and nothing really struck us until the very last one. And a home on 53rd Street near the English Library that she helped establish. And we, you know, it was not the house for us, but we saw at last what a tropical lifestyle could be like. It was just, it had a huge garden, really, really comfortable, pleasant house. And it just started the wheels spinning. And coincidentally, that year, I had gotten or given myself, I should say, a nice bonus from my business. And right after 9/11, you didn't really want to invest that in Wall Street. It was a very shaky period. And so I thought, well, maybe property is the right thing to do. So we came back, and, you know, it was early January. We were back in New York. And by February, she called us and she said, Alfredo, her husband, had found a great property that you should really consider. It was only $42,000, and it's a ruin, but it's got great bones, and it's just a deal that you should not pass up. Get on a plane. If you want it, you should get on a plane right now and come down here. And we did. And by February of that year, of 2002, we had bought this house where we're still living, and started remodeling it. It was quite a shock when we first walked in and saw it. We actually bought it sight unseen. And then Alfredo brought us here. We have photos of us nervously opening the door for the first time. And it was a complete ruin. Trees were growing in the ceilings and in the floors, and it was just a shambles. And I felt kind of nauseated, thinking, oh my God, how much money, what have we done? How much money is this going to take to restore? How long is it going to take? It's like, it was a huge project. But we dived in, and I don't quite know to this day how we pulled it off, but somehow we did. And after 14 months, it was ready to live in. And so I often quote this, I believe it's by Goethe, and he said, "Plunge, then reflect." And that's kind of how I lived my whole life. I don't overanalyze things. I'm a rather analytical person, but when it comes to life and experiences, I just kind of dive in and then worry about it later, and which sometimes works and sometimes doesn't. But in this case, you know, it worked. We had no plans. We never talked about moving here. It was really just for retirement, maybe, or maybe we would rent it out, or maybe we'd sell it. We didn't know what we were doing. And but meanwhile, we're still up in New York. We had left our condominium. We were terrified that property values were going to plummet after 9/11, but they didn't. Our property more than doubled in value for some bizarre reason that I'm not an economist. I could never hope to explain. But our property value doubled, and we thought, well, let's cash out. And we moved to a little cute little cabin on a hillside or a mountainside about an hour north of Manhattan, and commuted for six months after that, and going into Grand Central and trudging through snow. The snow was the worst part. After we moved in, which was around October 1st, it started snowing, and it didn't stop until we moved away. And we discovered that we actually were above the snow line, and just above the snow line. And we said to our realtor, "Thanks for telling us that," in an effort of full disclosure. Anyway, so we just hated it. And at one point, I had come down to Merida to supervise the construction, which we did about every 2 months. But one time, Keith couldn't come with me. It was actually on Valentine's Day of 2003. And I called him back in New York, and he had almost been killed, basically. His car was on a slippery slope of a mountainside near where we lived, and a snowplow almost crashed into him. I mean, nothing happened, but it was just really, really close call. We were so stressed out from the commute, the snow, the near crashes, and all of that stuff that Keith said, I don't know how we're going to do it, but we got to get out of here. And he said, look, we have our dream property already, our dream home in Yucatan. Let's just go move there. And we talked about it and you know, said, well, what are we going to do for money? Because we were not trust fund babies, either one of us. And said, well, we're clever. We'll think of something. And so we had about 2 years' worth of money to live on. And we literally packed it all up and shipped it down here and moved down. We got in our little vintage Mercedes station wagon, packed to the rim with objects as well, and about two or three cases of wine and that we had collected while still in New York. And we started driving south. We drove south, and we never looked back. We went all the way down the coast. We drove into Tampa, and we got on a ferry that was still operating at that time, which brought us over to Progreso, and we drove off the ferry and just kept driving south until we got to our house. And and again, like I said, we never really looked back. And you know, then of course, then the clouds start coming in. You wonder, what have I done again? You know, I've got to start earning some money. In the meantime, a little detail I left out is, as I was looking toward moving here, Keith and I started researching. I had, as I said, eaten a lot of and studied a lot about Mexican food over the course of time, but I never knew about Yucatecan food at all. I didn't realize it was a separate region, and I just didn't know what it was. So I decided to start studying that. So I did just some informal research while I was still living in New York. And meanwhile, also, Mark and I, my business partner at the time and still my dear friend, decided to start a small line, well, we hoped it would grow to be big, of gourmet Mexican food products. And we packaged some, the first things we did were some, which we still do, organic honeys from this region. Yucatecan honeys are considered by honey experts, and yes, there are such people in the world, to be the finest honeys in the world. And actually, there's a huge market for Yucatecan honeys in Europe, particularly in Germany. And we export a lot of it over there. I mean, not me, but Yucatan exports a lot of honey to Europe. And so we started packaging that. We also did some organic peanut butter, which I wanted to do for several reasons. Number one, peanuts are a new world food, and we tell stories about our food as well. And peanuts have been in Mesoamerica for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. And the Mayas in their farms, their milpa, as we call it, always have peanuts planted. And peanuts are really pretty much a regular part of the diet by this time. And I happen to love peanuts and peanut butter, and it was impossible to find here organic, natural peanut butter. It's all Jif or Peter Pan. And so I thought, well, why not do something that's tangential to or synchronous to the product line? And I thought, well, I looked around, and I knew that there were these cooking schools all over the world. Of course, in Tuscany and Provence and all over, you can go and tourists go and have a lovely day of cooking and eating and learning about the cuisine of that particular region. And I thought, well, why not do something like that? And that would tie in nicely with the product line. So it's one promotes the other. And so I started feverishly writing a website. I decided that would be my way of promoting it and the way of explaining what it's all about. And you see, these things would never have happened just 10 years before, because when there was no internet, I would not have a business. I could not have afford it to take out full page ads in Food and Wine magazine or something like that. But with the internet, it was very easy. So I started a website. I explained the school, took lots of pictures, and which you guys contributed to at several points. You came over and took classes, and I started it by November of 2003. That was the year that we moved here. We moved here on Easter Day 2003, and by November the school had opened, and from that day it was a hit. And I have a high ranking in TripAdvisor, and you know, we get about 450 students a year now. We offer all kinds of classes. We have a one-day workshop that's just a full intensive from about 8:30 till 4:30, and we just eat and cook all day long, and we have a great market tour. And then we also do some three-day packages and week-long packages that are more intensive, and then involve excursions to food-related places. There, for example, there's one place I love to take people down near Uxmal, which is a major Maya site. It's a little town called Santa Elena, and there are several families there who manage what we call solares, S-O-L-A-R, solar. It's like a kitchen garden, and it's a very common practice in the Maya world. It's a way of supplementing their diet from their regular field staples of corn, beans, and squash. So they'll have in there all kinds of chiles and tomatoes and things that you might not have in the farm. And lots of useful plants too, like cotton. And it's just a fascinating thing to see. They have turkeys and pigs running around, and kids running around, and all kinds of things that they have for both edible things and medicinal things in these gardens. And they're fascinating. And so I love to take people on those in our excursions. That's for the three-day or week-long packages. And then we also have, we started just a couple of years ago, that's been very successful, tasting tours that don't involve any cooking. But they're great fun. We take them, it's about 3 or 4 hours, take them to we have several different versions. One that's really fun, we call it Cantina Crawl, and we take them to different cantinas around. Cantinas are really making a comeback here in Merida. They used to be these all-male enclaves, but they now are more family-oriented, and women are allowed, and children even go in. And the thing is, when you order drinks at these places, even a non-alcoholic beverage, they bring you plates of food for free. And so you can get stuffed and just for the price of your beverages. And so they're very popular. They go way back, at least, 150 years probably. And like I said, they're making a resurgence now. And so that's a great fun tour. We do another one that's called Street Eats, and we take them to street stalls and surprising places like that, or into the market to have snacks. People are always curious about the food. You know, I see this appealing-looking food on the street, but I'm afraid to eat it. Is it safe? And so we take them to places where we know that it's perfectly fine. And that's a really great, fun one as well.
Street food is some of the best food, you know?
Well, it is. And it's some of the most real food, because it's not trying to be anything other than what it is. And some people get very creative because, of course, there's competition that emerges. So yeah, that's a great fun tour as well.
Now, you know, you've indulged in all sorts of street food and Yucatecan cuisine and everything, and you just had a book that came out, correct?
I did. It came out in late March of last year, of 2014. I can't believe it's been that long ago, coming up on 2 years ago. And actually, it was the result of, it's called Yucatan, a Culinary Recipes from a Culinary Expedition. And it resulted from those early years, still back in New York, when I started researching the food. And the first thing you learn about is Cochinita pibil. It's everywhere you look. If you want to think of a synonym for Yucatecan food, it's Cochinita pibil. This is a small pig that's marinated in a special seasoning blend that we have here, and that's bright red, and then it's cooked in a pit, like sort of like barbecue. And so I learned what that was and where that all came from. And that was some of my earliest research. Then meanwhile, as I mentioned, and I built the website for the school, I decided to kind of have a virtual cookbook. And I started doing research on this area and all different again, I told you I like stories when it comes to food. I want to know where it came from, who made it, where did it originate? Was this ingredient from here, or was it imported by the Europeans? Did you know, for example, that before Europeans came, we had no onions. We had none of the allium varieties, no garlic, no chives, nothing like that, no leeks. That was, yeah, after European contact. So it's hard to imagine our food without those flavors, since we use so much onion now and garlic. So I got obsessed with researching all this about ingredients, places, stories behind different dishes. Huevos motuleños is a great story. This is a Motul-style eggs, as it's translated. And it came about because of a governor that we had in Yucatan in the 1920s, who was later executed, or you might say assassinated. But it's just a fascinating story of how he, because of a request that he had one day at a power luncheon, this dish was invented. And the story is great because this power luncheon was held in a cenote, one of our famous limestone sinkholes here, a cenote in Motul. And that's how the whole thing came about. But so these kind of stories fascinate me endlessly. And I just compiled dozens of them and started posting them on my website. And then more and more were put up, and I just kept researching and collecting more and more. And finally, one year, this was, I guess, in 2008 or 2009, and I get this phone call, and a woman leaves a message. She says, "Hello, I'm trying to reach David Sterling. My name is Diana Kennedy." Now, for those of you out there who don't know who Diana Kennedy is, she is the English language. She is actually British. My humble accent probably did not do it justice, but she is from England. She's about 95 years old now, and she has been in Mexico for over 50 years researching Mexican food. She is the doyenne of Mexican cuisine. People call her the Julia Child of Mexican food, which I don't like the comparison very much, but it gives you an idea of what she's about. She is the authority on Mexican food in the English language world. She called me up and she wanted to meet me. She was in Merida and she came over and we got along really well. And so well, in fact, that later, just a few months later, she invited me to come and visit her. She lives in Michoacán, in the western part of the country, and I went over to visit her, and we had a great time. We just really clicked. And then when I got back, I asked her, "Diana, why don't you come over here at Christmas this year, and we'll teach a class together?" And she did that, and we just got along really well. She stayed with us for a couple of weeks, and we went what she calls pueblearing. That means to go from pueblo to pueblo, town to town, just driving around and seeing what there is to see and eating everything along the way, of course. And during one of our little adventures, she said to me, "David, you really know the material. You really must do a cookbook." And I took that as a great compliment. And I told her that by this point, I had submitted a proposal for my book to a couple of agents. And I was dismissed politely but brusquely, basically saying, "Well, unless you have a vehicle, we can never sell a book like this." Vehicle, I assume that they meant like a TV show, you know, unless you're a famous author, a famous restaurateur like Rick Bayless or somebody like that you would just never make it. So I was very discouraged by that. I told her that, and she uttered an expletive and stamped her foot and said, "That's just ridiculous. I'm going to introduce you to my publisher." And so she did. Within a few months, she had introduced me to her editor, and Casey Cottrell at University of Texas Press, to whom I am eternally indebted, as well as to Diana. And I submitted my proposal to them, and they immediately accepted it. And so I had a lot of research compiled, but then once I got the contract, I had to really put my nose to the grindstone and started working in serious. Took me, about 3 years to put it all together. Well, I got 2 years, but 3 years by the time you count all the editing and so on, that back and forth with the editorial office. And so that was quite an intensive project. I used to get up at 5 a.m. every morning, and not because I made myself, but because I just hopped out of bed and wanted to get to work, and then would work into the night. And it was an intensive labor of love, and it took me all over the peninsula. And again, digging up stories, like I explained about, like, the Motul style eggs, just finding all kinds of stories. I went even into Campeche, and that's a state to the east, to the west of here. And I had so much good luck, happened to stumble upon Three Kings Day celebration, and that's in the 6th of January. And these festivals, people, families sponsored them, and save money for years to be able to throw these huge parties that are for their patron saints. And and these are just very humble people. But this one family that I met started out, the patriarch had started out with one pig several years ago. It was so successful, and he had earned enough money to, had people donate, then other families make donations so that they can get this cash going. By the second year, he had two pigs, and so on, until the time I was there, they had 10 pigs at this festival. And this mountain, their house was on the side of a big, big hill, and the backyard was not exactly a yard, but the side of the mountain, and with little sort of, you might say, landings all the way up. As you climb up, and at every single landing, there was someone making some kind of food. There were men who were boiling big vats of lard, who were frying pieces of pork, ribs, and things like that. There was another station where women were had their elbows up to their elbows in pig blood. They were making morcilla, which is a famous Spanish blood sausage that's absolutely delicious, and so on. It was the most fabulous event. Lots of dancing, music, and the whole community participates, which is what makes it so fun. And that's how the book evolved and how it turned out. And I was very, very honored. This was last year in April, to be awarded with several awards. I got, first of all, one that was new and that no one's heard of, but it came with cash. So I was very happy about that. A nice chunk of
that's
cash.
That's always a good award.
Cash is a good award. It's called the Art of Eating Prize. And Art of Eating is actually a magazine, an excellent magazine, that people write sort of poetically about food. And it's not so much recipes as it is thinking about food and pondering food and like I said, kind of writing poetically about food. It's a wonderful, wonderful magazine. And it's based on the writings of M.F.K. Fisher, who is a famous writer, food writer. Well, she's now deceased, but that's how she wrote about food. It was just thinking about the poetry of food, sort of like Proust or something. And that I won that prize. And then the big news was that I was nominated for the James Beard Foundation Best International Cookbook of the Year. And I was nominated. It's like the Academy Awards. When the awards are held in New York City, you don't know if you're winning, if you've won or not. They don't tell you that. And you take your chances and go. And I, at one point, was considering not going because I thought, if I go up there and I don't win, I'm going to be really pissed. And so, but then I thought, if I don't go and I win, I'll be really pissed. So I thought, well, I'm going to go for the experience. And because what a treat to be around all these foodies. Rick Bayless was there, Mario Batali, on and on, all these, you know, incredible figures in food, Martha Stewart. And it was just a great event, it was. And then they announced the Best International Cookbook of the Year, and it was me. And I went up and I gave my little speech that I had prepared in front of hundreds of people, and my voice was trembling like a baby. I was so nervous. And then I go back and sit back down, and you know, we're at dessert now, and I had no idea that this is how it was done, but they actually then name a best cookbook of the year, and that's the end of the show. That's the very, very end, like I said, with dessert, and I didn't know that this was an award, and they're talking about it, and Mark had gone with me, actually, Mark Randall, my former business partner that I mentioned several times, and we're sitting there, and the woman gets up. She's the head of the foundation, and she says, every year we look at international cookbooks, and this year the Mexico has been really explored. And Mark starts screaming. He said, David, it's you. It's going to be you. And screaming at the top of his lungs. And I kept saying, shut up. I want to hear what she's saying. And indeed, it was me.
Wow. Congratulations. I didn't know you got that reward as well.
Yes, I did. So that was terrific. And I have the two medals hanging up in my kitchen now above some jars of spices. So it's very fitting. And so that was a great, great honor and simply terrific. And I, you know, thinking about it right now even gives me goosebumps.
Yeah, I told you, as I went out and bought, you can buy David's book on Amazon. I bought the book and I wanted to have you autograph it, but to be honest with you, it's a fabulous book, just a little too heavy for me to haul all the way over to Merida for your autograph.
Yes, it weighs 6.5 pounds. So I have stacks of books here that I sell to local people. I've ordered hundreds of them and sold them all, but often not to my students who come here because they don't want to weigh their luggage down. It's just so heavy. But what I have a solution here that when people are here, I have a charming little card, a little square white card with my name embossed on it, and I will do a dedication on that and sign
it. Oh, nice.
And they can keep that in the book. So yeah, so that's my little solution for that problem of the weight of the book. Quite a tome, yes.
Oh, but it's beautiful, and I mean, it's just full of fabulous recipes, fabulous photography, and just, I mean, I was tickled to hear about the book and everything, and go, I know him. I knew him when he was just doing this little cooking school way back when.
Yes.
So I was really excited for you. Congratulations. I can't think of a book that would be more worthy because it's just beautiful.
Thank you. Well, you know, that reminds me, you were even here well before I became a television celebrity. That's quite a joke because I'm hardly a celebrity. But I have appeared on Martha Stewart. She came here and did actually the first TV show she ever did outside the country. She did here in Merida. She has a good friend here and came down to visit and decided to do her show here. So I was on her show. Then I was on Rick Bayless's show, Mexico One Plate at a Time.
Oh, and I didn't know that. Wow.
Oh, yeah. And he just came back last week. And they
heard he was in town.
Yeah, and they filmed this next season coming up, which will start in September on PBS. The entire season of 13 episodes is filmed in Yucatan. And so I was one of the spots that'll be on that as well. And I took him to a bakery, a wonderful bakery here that he fell in love with. And I took him to a Cocina Económica. Cocina Económicas are little family-run businesses that operate often out of people's houses. And the woman and her family, her daughters and maybe the aunts and grandmothers all cook together in the kitchen. And then they'll serve the food either in the living room, or they often will clear off the porch if they have a porch and set up tables there. And they're charming. And again, talk about real food. It's really like mama would make. And just absolutely wonderful. And the women are, it's a family enterprise. Everyone gets involved. You'll have little kids serving you your beverages and bringing you your forks and knives and things. It's the most charming experience. So I took them to one of those as well, and they filmed that too. So I can't wait to see the episode. Like I said, it launches in September. I'm not sure when mine will be on.
Well, please keep us posted on that. I'd love to tell people and, you know, and cheer you on. I want to tune in myself. I have a question. You know, when we had talked about doing this interview today, we were talking about, you know, some of the places that you would recommend people to go to and everything. And I really, after hearing all your great stories and where you took Martha Stewart and Rick Bayless, so what would you tell people who are coming down to visit Merida or the Yucatan Peninsula? Do you have like two or three, even four, like typical foods that if you're here, you really need to try these. You really need to try these foods to really appreciate Yucatecan food and the culture that we live in.
Well, yeah, there are many I could name. There is a restaurant here in town called Sikef, S-I-Q-U-E-F-F, and it is actually a Lebanese name, and it's a Lebanese restaurant. This is the restaurant that in the 1920s invented the dish of Motul-style eggs. Their original operation was over in Motul, which is a little town northeast of here, and they invented this dish for Felipe Carrillo Puerto, who was the governor at the time. Like I mentioned, this was in the 1920s. And they still serve this dish. Huevos Motuleños, it's called. Motul-style eggs is a must-have dish. It's what happened was, the story was that Carrillo Puerto, the governor, liked to have lots of garnishes. He liked to have lots of little side dishes whenever he ate anything. And so this time when he had this power lunch, this is the legend, when he had this big power lunch or power breakfast, they were serving eggs. They had so many people in attendance that the chef was concerned that they had not enough placeware, tableware, dishes and things. So instead of serving all these little garnishes and side dishes in separate plates, they piled it all on top of one plate. That's how it happened. And so that's simply, but it is kind of, people were recognized that it's kind of like, huevos rancheros or something. You have a tostada on the bottom, that's a fried tortilla, smeared with refried beans. You put the eggs on top of that, fried eggs. You pour on a tomato sauce, and then you sprinkle it with ham and peas and grated Edam cheese. And it's absolutely fantastic, and especially when done well. And the Sikef really does it very well. There's another place that I highly recommend, which is in Valladolid, which is a town about 2 hours east of here. It is midway between Cancun and Merida, and it's easy to get to. It's really, really easy. It's near Chichen Itza, the big Maya site, and there's right on the main square is a great old hotel called Maison del Marques, and you can't miss it. It's really
one of my favorites.
Oh, yeah. And they sell a dish there that is very typical of Valladolid. It was originated there, and it's called pavo en escabeche oriental. That means pickled turkey from the east. Oriental doesn't mean like Asia. It means east because it's east of Merida. That's how it got that name. And isn't that funny?
Yeah, it is.
And I call it soused turkey. It's cooked in vinegar with a lot of black pepper and cloves and pickled white onions. And it's served in a bowl like a soup or something. And it's absolutely, my mouth is actually watering. It is so delicious. And it's just very representative of Valladolid especially. And you know, it has our native local turkey in it, and then these wonderful Spanish, which are in fact Andalusian or Moorish spices with the black pepper and the cloves, all those Asian spices. So indeed, there is kind of a reference to the Asian thing there. And then lots and lots of white vinegar. And it's tart, it's tangy, it's even a little spicy because of the pepper. And they always put a charred chile on top too, like an Anaheim-type chile. And it's exquisite. We also have the famous, there's a dish called queso relleno, and it's stuffed Edam cheese. The Dutch were here in the 1700s. They were they never occupied Yucatan, but they were all off in the Caribbean. But they had contact with Yucatan because they were pirates. They were fierce and bloody pirates. And they always had on board their ships, as did many European ships, the Edam cheese, which is the big red round ball cheese. And that is, it travels well because the outer surface develops a kind of rind, and it keeps the cheese inside nice and fresh and edible. And it also was a way of avoiding rickets on long ocean voyages because of the calcium in the cheese. You're not going to travel with big buckets of milk, but you can take the cheese. So that arrived here, and it's kind of been here ever since. So the way that we eat the cheese here, typically we have sweetened fruit for dessert, a candied fruit, papaya it could be, or it could be even squash. Absolutely delicious. And the thing to do is to scoop out some of the cheese and from the middle of the ball and put that on your fruit. It's like our fruit and cheese course. Well, after a month or so, you've eaten all the cheese from the center and you're left with this rind. And we're very frugal here. We don't waste anything. And so apparently at some point, some creative chef got the idea of filling that hollow cheese now with picadillo, which is chopped or ground meat. It can be pork or it can be beef or a mixture. They even do seafood in over your way in Playa del Carmen. It's a famous restaurant, El Faisan y el Venado. Yeah, and they do one, a famous, delicious one with seafood. Anyway, you stuff that with the mixture of meat of whatever kind, and then you steam it. So you see the cheese gets soft, and it cooks the meat inside, and that's served with a white gravy that's made thickened with corn and then a tomato sauce as well. It's delicious, and that's so typical of here. And you can tell from the dishes that I've mentioned that you have never seen any of those in the rest of Mexico. These are things that are really, really typical of Yucatan, and that you won't find elsewhere unless you happen to go to a Yucatecan restaurant, which they do have over in the rest of the country. But they're just really iconic of Yucatan.
And let me ask you, since you mentioned Central Mexico, they don't eat really as picante as we do here, do they?
Well, actually, in Yucatan, cooks here say, and the Yucatecan friends that I have, say that the comida de Mexico es muy condimentada. The food of Mexico is very spicy. And when they say Mexico, they mean over there, away from Yucatan and the rest of the country. They do because, you know, they use more dried chiles. They use dried chiles to make mole and things like that. But, and so it is spicy. However, we do not do that here. But what we do is we put on the chile sauce at the end, just before eating. And you know, our chile sauce mostly is made with the habanero chile, which is
my favorite.
Was at one time the world's hottest chile. Nowadays, they've developed all kinds of new hybrids that are even hotter so that they can make really hot chile sauce and make a lot of money off of it. But habanero was at one point, actually just until about 20 years ago, the world's hottest chile, with about 350,000 Scoville heat units. So it's way up there. And so our food is very, very hot, but you can control the heat because it depends on how much of that sauce you put on. But if you just eat, most of our food is not that picante.
Yeah, I guess I never really thought about it because, I mean, I am always dumping hot sauce on it. So I just assume, you know, and I know I've been in Mexico City and I'm like, can I have a bottle of habanero sauce? And they kind of look at me like, you must be from Yucatan.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no, I'm the exact same way. You get accustomed to it, and food does not taste right without habanero to us after you're accustomed to it. And I can't get enough of it. Yesterday, okay, I was in my kitchen, and there were some leftover habaneros from class last week, and I just had such a craving, and I picked one up, and I ate the whole thing with nothing. And I soon had to reach for a piece of cheese. That will help calm down the heat.
To break the heat.
Yeah, but it was just so you get a craving for it. Well, you know, because it stimulates the production of endorphins. And so, like, kind of like chocolate, it can make you feel high. A little, not high, but just happy.
Yeah, well, I guess if I had a choice, habanero or chocolate, I'll opt for the chocolate. But I certainly want habanero tastes much better on my eggs than chocolate would.
Yes, it does. And also, now, how about chocolate with some habanero? You know, they're
love
doing
it.
A lot of chocolates with it that have spices in it and chile. That's another ancient formula from the Mayas. The Aztecs as well. Often in their chocolate beverage, they would put chili.
Yeah, no, I like it. Down in Tulum, we have chocolate habanero ice cream. Absolutely love. And I even make Christmas gifts, I have a Mayan chocolate recipe that I make, and I package it all up and give it as gifts for people. I think it's a wonderful combination, the spice and the chocolate.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, yum. That sounds great.
I know. Now I'm getting hungry.
I know. Oh, me too. It's almost lunchtime.
I know it is. Well, David, I cannot thank you enough for talking with us today. And so tell me, well, I know how to get in touch with you, but why don't you, how can everybody who's listening, how can they get in touch with you, whether it's find out more about your book or cooking school or your tours? What's the best places to reach you?
It's very easy. I'll give you two options. If you simply go to Google and do Merida Cooking School Merida, I'm the first thing that pops up. So it's pretty easy to find me. If you want to just have an email address, I conduct practically everything through email. All of my classes are set up that way. Just because, you know, you have to arrange with people the time and all that stuff. And that is info@losdos.com. And I just will spell it. It's LOS as in Sam, hyphen D as in David, OS as in Sam.com. That's the name of my school, is Los Dos. And it just has a little hyphen in there. And that will direct you right into my mailbox.
Excellent, excellent. Are you on Facebook too? Is Los Dos on Facebook?
Los Dos Cooking School Merida Yucatan is also on Facebook. Yes, you can easily find me there.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, I know I always say this. I swear I say it. What? How many times? Anytime I'm in touch with you or Keith, I'm always like, I'm going to come and see you. I'm going to come and see you. I'd love to come and cook with you or sit down and just have a tequila or a glass of wine with you and Keith, just so we can all catch up, because we just don't see enough of each other over the years.
I know, it's true, and we will do that, and 2016 is we have time to say we're going to do it this year.
We are going to do it this year. That's great. Well, David, thanks so much. I really appreciate all the time, and I will see you very soon, and I will give you all the information about when we're going to air this so that you've got it, and I'll also give you some tweets and everything else for you. So
that's perfect. I appreciate it, Kate.
Well, thanks for tuning in today and listening to our podcast, and a big thank you to David. As a reminder, you can find David's cookbook on Amazon, Yucatan, Recipes from a Culinary Expedition. If you're looking to want to spend some time cook with David, just Google Merida Cooking Schools. He's the first one to come up. And if you want David's contact information, you can always email me, askkay@locogringo.com. If you're coming down to the Yucatan Peninsula, I invite you to visit our website, locogringo.com. Our staffs really want to show you an incredible experience because they love it here. And we also want to turn you on to some great food. We know some foodies, don't we? So please reach out to us anytime. And we'll talk to you next week.
Thanks for listening. If you like the show, be sure to subscribe. For links, show notes, and more information, head on over to locogringo.com or give us a call toll free at 800-478-0081.
Porque se tragó la luna. Estaba enferma la rana, su madre soba que soba, dedos de pluma la panza. Pensó ranita que luna era una toronja blanca, y aunque la luna es de leche, la leche estaba cortada. Croa, croa, dedos de pluma, croa, croa, dedos de agua, croa, croa.